Hey, good morning, NCC. Welcome to Worship and Word Online. In just a moment, I'm going to bring a word from God's Word. We're going to talk about how to stay fresh in your walk with Christ. So come on, let's worship together. I'll see you in just a minute.
Every breath we could ever live for you. New Community Church, welcome back to our online services. We're so excited to continue to get to worship with you. Easter was amazing last week. You guys were generous beyond what we could have ever hoped for. So thank you for continuing to give to the mission of New Community Church. We do want to remind you there are two ways that you can give. You can go to newcommunitychurch.com/give, or you can text the dollar amount to the number on the screen.
Hey, good morning, NCC. Welcome to our worship and word experience. We want to thank you for joining us every Sunday. This has been 5 weeks we've been doing this. And if you don't mind, send us some love, some heart symbols, some thumbs up. And those of you that are joining now, just want to tell you that we love you and we're praying for you. Also want to make mention of the fact that we are praying for our missions partners. We just like to ask you to join us in praying for them and believing that God is going to provide for them the resources they need to do the job they are called to do. We're starting this three-part series called Fresh. We're focusing on the word fresh. We want to stay fresh in our walk with Christ. We want to believe that God gives us that refreshment from His Word. And so as we start today, I just want to encourage you to open your Bibles, get your heart ready, and let's believe that God is going to speak to us through His Word today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for today, for the opportunity to gather this way online. There are families that are worshiping you today all over Muskogee and the greater Muskogee area, those that are studying your word. And I just pray that you would help us as we learn more about you, help us to know how to share the gospel with others and to tell your story. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. So fresh. I love things that are fresh. What are some of the things that come to your mind when you think of the word fresh? Obviously, fresh bread. Y'all like fresh bread. Maybe you can put in the field below, you can just type in what you think and give us a shout out of what you like to see fresh. Maybe fresh water, fresh eggs, fresh strawberries. I don't know about y'all, but I love fresh buttermilk. Yeah, I said it, fresh buttermilk. Of course, you could say, well, buttermilk is always fresh because it is buttermilk, and you're probably saying gross. Hey, the biggest thing for me is fresh air. I don't think we pause long enough to think about how valuable every breath that we breathe really is. Every breath that we breathe is a gift from God. We see in the scripture where Jesus, after his resurrection, the Bible says, met with his disciples, and we're looking at John chapter 20. Let's turn there now and check out these verses. John chapter 20, verse 19. It says that on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, which was a Sunday, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." So this is after his resurrection. He appears to them and tells them to be at peace. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. I'm sure they were. They were fired up. They were excited because they had just seen him crucified and they saw him being buried. Now he's appearing to them and they're so excited. Jesus said again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so am I sending you." And when he had said this, look what it says here. He breathed on them. Obviously, it was not during the coronavirus. He wasn't wearing a mask, but he breathed on his disciples. That seems like a strange thing to do, right? He breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." So think about that just for a minute. What does it mean to you when you think of taking a breath of fresh air? Think back to when you were born. The first thing that happened when you were born is when you came out of the womb, you took a deep breath of fresh air. Everyone just breathe in right now. Just breathe that fresh air. So when you think of breathing, when you think of how it's possible that we are alive, you have to think of CPR. Well, what is CPR? CPR comes from the word cardiopulmonary, and then it's resuscitation. So cardiopulmonary resuscitation, you combine both the heart and the lungs. Every breath that we breathe has a connection with every beat of our hearts. Isaiah chapter 42 and verse 5, it says, "The Lord," or Yahweh, "created the heavens and stretched them out and spread out the earth, what comes from it, and he gives breath to people on it and spirit to those who walk in it." God gives us every breath that we breathe, we give credit and glory to God. Every beat of our heart, we give credit and glory to God. Now, here's an interesting fact. Maybe you didn't know that if a person lives to be, let's say, 80 years, living 80 years, that's a long life, maybe 90 years. If you live to be 80 years, you're going to breathe 700 million breaths. Also, the airways in our lungs amount to about 1,500 miles. If you were to stretch out the lungs and lay it flat, our lungs take up about 1,000 square feet of space. So we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And every breath that we breathe is a gift from God. And so we give God praise. The Bible says, "Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord." And so we live our lives to bring glory to God with every breath that we breathe. When you study Scripture, you see how important it is, how important our lives are, how important it is for us to take note of the fact that we are creatures made for the glory of God, by God, and for God. Every breath is a gift. Right now, it seems like the population of our world is concerned about the coronavirus. Why? Because it affects the lungs. It affects how we breathe. Some say that what it does, it makes it impossible for the hemoglobin and the oxygen molecules to work properly in the lungs. So here's a point that I want us to take note of, a big point, and that is this. When sin captured Adam's heart, it resulted in shortness of breath for the entire human race. Every breath that we breathe, every beat of our heart, everything that we do in this life, all of the problems that we see in our world, all the situations, the crime, the sickness, the disease, the issues that really trouble us, go back to Adam's sin in the garden. So when Adam and Eve sinned, their sin that they committed caused the entire human race to have a shortness of breath. Let me explain. When you think of issues that seem to trouble you, know that maybe you're going through a rough time and it's like you're holding your breath and you're worried about what's going to happen. Metaphorically, you're trying to catch your breath. And even the disease that plagues humanity, all of the diseases that affect us, that cause us to be mortal. We are mortal beings. We are fragile. So every breath is a gift. And when you see in Genesis 2:7 that God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living soul. Adam and Eve received the breath from God in the very beginning. And because of sin, now mankind has inherited this death gene, and so there is, metaphorically, shortness of breath. It's like people can't breathe. You know what that feels like? Like you're struggling in life, you're worried about maybe finances, you're worried about health, and maybe you're holding your breath right now, wondering what's going to happen next. However you look at it, we are struggling to breathe because of the sin that we've all inherited from Adam. This is the bad news. In 1 Corinthians 15:21, here's some good news. Check it out, y'all. For as by man came death, by man has also come the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam all die, also in Christ shall all be made alive. What is that saying? It's saying that the message of Christ is really all about being refreshed. The message of Jesus breathes life into our dying souls. The message of Jesus affects us supernaturally. It affects us in a real way. And so today we're going to see how accepting Jesus, we're going to see how believing in Jesus truly has a supernatural effect on all of us. Let's back up just for a minute. Maybe you didn't know this, but Roman crucifixion was designed for an unusual way for someone to die. Not just bleeding out. Of course, when they were nailed to crosses, they bled out. But it was really an instrument of torture that caused the individual to suffocate, which is why when they were hanging on the cross, and there were crosses all over the Roman Empire, people were killed on a regular basis. Criminals were killed this way. It was a slow and painful death. It was death by suffocation. And they would have to push themselves up on the cross so that they could take a deep breath in their lungs. This is true with Jesus. As he was hanging on the cross, every breath was laborious and it was a struggle to breathe. They would come by and they would break the criminal's legs that were hanging on the cross so that it would, after hours and hours and hours, maybe days of this torturing pain that they would experience through suffocation, the breaking of the legs would cause the victim to die quickly because they couldn't push themselves up to breathe anymore. And the scripture talks about Jesus breathing his last breath. And I want us to hone in on this verse and see how it applies to our lives today. In Mark chapter 15 and verse 37, look what it says here. It says, "But Jesus, with a loud cry, he gave his last breath. And at that moment," what moment? The moment that Jesus took his last breath, "the temple curtain ripped right down the middle. And when the Roman captain, standing guard in front of him, saw that he had quit breathing, he said, 'This has to be the Son of God.'" Y'all, check this out. This is amazing. Something happened when Jesus took his last breath. Here he is, the eternal Son of God, was born a virgin birth as a baby in a manger, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lived a sinless life. Now he's hanging on the cross for the sins of the world. And the veil in the temple rips in two. This is significant, showing that the Holy Spirit is now going to be accessible to average people like you and I. And also this Roman soldier that was in the process of crucifying Jesus has this epiphany when he sees Jesus taking his last breath. He says, "This has to be the Son of God." He declared that this has to be the Son of God. The very moment that Jesus quit breathing, something supernatural happened. Something was released in the earth's atmosphere. When he gave his last breath, he was basically showing us that his death by suffocation was so that we could accept him and breathe easy. Him giving every drop of blood, yes, his blood was precious blood, but he also gave his last breath for us. How does this affect you? When you study the gospel, when you see what Christ has done so that we could have that breath of fresh air, how does that affect your heart? I think when we study the gospel, it's like divine CPR. It's like divine cardiopulmonary resuscitation. God's word literally changes us from the inside out. Look what it says in 2 Timothy 3:16. It says that every part of Scripture is God-breathed. Every part of Scripture is God-breathed, useful in one way or another, showing us truth, exposing our rebellion, correcting our mistakes, and training us to live God's way. Y'all, it affects who we are. When you study the Scripture and know that the God-breathed Scripture, the story about Jesus. And so that's my big second takeaway point, and that is that when the God-breathed story of Jesus captures our heart, we cannot help but breathe out life-giving words. It affects our speech. The Scripture says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. David said, let the meditations of my heart, the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God. So every beat of our heart affects our attitude, affects obviously what we say. So let me say it again. When the God-breathed story of Jesus captures your heart, you will breathe out life-giving words. Your words will be edifying. Your words will be like a breath of fresh air to others. So whenever there's a word problem, it's probably because there is a heart problem. So I believe that God's word affects us in our hearts. The word of God affects us at a very deep level and teaches us how to live, how to talk, and how to inspire others with our words. It's a breath of fresh air. I like what it says in Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. It says, repent, therefore turn back, that your sins will be blotted out. And it says that the times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord, and that they may send the Christ appointed for you, that is Jesus. And that's my prayer, is that as you study Scripture, as you see Jesus in his life, his death, his burial and resurrection, the effect that that has, when you see that and take that in and it captures your heart, it will truly transform you. It will truly refresh you. Let me tell you a story. It's a true story. A story about a government official. We would call him a wife stealer. We'll call him a killer. Here's how the story plays out. There was a woman that was minding her own business one day at her house, and this stranger, this government official, knocks on her door. Now, you have to keep in mind that her husband is out fighting in the war. So he knocks on the door, and he ends up having a relationship with this woman and an adulterous relationship. And soon after, he sends her husband to the front lines, and he gets killed. He ends up marrying this woman. And so there you have it. You have adultery, you have murder, you have deceit. And you ask yourself, well, does this person deserve to be forgiven? Who is this person? Well, it's none other than King David. David wrote most of the Psalms. David, yeah, the same guy, the man after God's own heart. He was involved in something so terrible, so awful, so criminal. And yet, when Nathan the prophet came to him and told him that he had done something wrong and preached a message to him, a powerful, illustrated message, David immediately recognized the sin of his own heart and was quick to confess it. And in Psalm 51, he said, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew in me a right spirit. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. He said, restore unto me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with your free spirit. Then he said, I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will be converted. What David was saying is that, God, I need you to clean my heart. And if you clean my heart, and you forgive me, and restore unto me this, if you refresh my soul, I'll be able to share the good news and the story of your salvation to others. And I love the way this reads in the Message paraphrase. Check this out. David is saying this. He said, soak me in your laundry and I'll come out clean. Scrub me and I'll have a snow white life. Tune me in to the foot tapping songs. Set these once broken bones to dancing. Don't look too close for blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a Genesis week from the chaos of my life. Don't throw me out with the trash or fail to breathe holiness in me. Bring me back from gray exile. And then he says, put a fresh wind in my sails. Basically, God, he's saying, refresh me so that I can refresh others. forgive me, God, and I'm gonna forgive others. And that's certainly true. What happens when we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit through our obedience to the gospel, turning from sin to Christ. The Holy Spirit floods and fills our lives and breathes life into us so that we can be life-giving in our words to others. My prayer for you is that you can, this week, maybe share this message with someone on your Facebook account, just post it on your page, or maybe you can call a friend, talk to somebody about Jesus. And certainly you need to pray that your soul could be fed and refreshed by the Holy Spirit. Just like Jesus breathed on his disciples and said, "Receive you the Holy Spirit. Whoever sins you forgive, they are forgiven." The same is true for us. We're going to go out and change the world by being loving, forgiving, and just edifying with our words and actions to others. God bless you today. We're praying for you, and we love you. So glad you could be a part of this today. We're thankful you joined with us. What a great word we just heard from Pastor Simeon. What can you do next with it? If you would, share this with somebody. Share it on Facebook or Instagram. A lot of people would love to have the hope that we heard today. If you're in a connect group, this is a great time just to stay in it and connect with others. If you're not in a connect group, we've got some great groups that are going on right now. Email me at jeremy@newcommunitychurch.com and we'll get you set up in a connect group. Last but not least, for any information or if you're a first-time listener, visitor, we'd love to connect with you. Go to our website, newcommunitychurch.com, and hit the connect button. God bless you. Have a great day.